It is 8 o'clock on today. Victoria's roadmap to freedom has experts divided. This morning, one of the nation's leading doctors has cast doubt on the modelling used in the Premier's plan. Today, Melbourne reporter Christine Ahern leads our coverage. Chris, there are dire predictions for Victoria's health system.
Well, the Burnett Institute, Ali, provided modelling for the Victorian government, and it has predicted that up to 3,000 Victorians could die of COVID by December, and that our caseload will peak at 4,500 by mid-December. However, Dr. Nick Coatsworth has told Today on Nine he doesn't entirely believe the modelling.
There's a case to be made that the modelling is a little bit overcautious, a little bit overrepresenting the likely impact on the Victorian health system.
Of course, on the other side is the business groups wanting us to open up even quicker than the roadmap is suggesting. Of course, this has been labelled a very slow and cautious roadmap, particularly when you compare it to New South Wales. We're going to be in lockdown with a curfew for another 5 weeks. That is when 70% of us will be double dosed. It's not really till 80% of us are double dosed, predicted on November 5, that indoor settings will start to reopen in hospitality and retail, but even then with density limits and only for the fully vaccinated. Will we have a crowd at the Melbourne Cup? Well, we simply don't know because major events were not included in the roadmap.
Alan? Okay, thanks, Chris.
Leaders across Western Sydney are welcoming an easing of restrictions this morning, which brings COVID hotspots in line with the rest of the city. Today's Gabrielle Boyle joins us now from Fairfield in the city's southwest. Gabby, residents must be a lot happier this morning.
They certainly will be, Carl. These are small changes, but they're significant ones, particularly when you consider most of West and Southwest Sydney has spent all of winter locked up inside their homes, really effectively unable to leave. From today moving forward, they are able to exercise for as long as they please. No time restriction there. You're able to take a picnic too if you're fully vaccinated, up to 5 people joining together for that activity. There's also some relaxation of the rules surrounding shopping, and the singles bubble is back up and running if you are outside your LGA as well. So you can have someone visit your house, even if they don't live in your local area. For local leaders, these changes have been given the double thumbs up.
I'm really happy, not only for my community, but really happy that we're no longer going to be singled out. Really happy that we're not going to be discriminated against. And I think that's very important moving forward for us to be one Sydney.
Carl, one other change worth noting. If you are an essential worker living in these areas, you do need to have at least one dose of the vaccine if you're to travel outside of your LGA. There are exemptions you can get from your doctor if that is the case. And also it's worth noting that you need to head to the Services New South Wales website to register your trip. Carl?
Gabby, thank you.
Queensland's race to vaccinate is in full swing with lines already forming at a vax hub in Brisbane. Today, Queensland reporter Jessica Millwood is there. Jess, good morning to you. It's a busy morning already.
Good morning. That's right, Alex. We're here at the Brisbane Exhibition and Convention Centre here at Southbank, and there are already lines. We are back to appointment only, however, after the weekend's supervisor weekend where walk-ins were welcome. But Queensland Health say it was so successful they're looking at making it walk-ins every day of the week and potentially even opening up a 24/7 vax hub. We broke records on the weekend. 33,000 people vaccinated on Saturday. That was actually 1,000 more than New South Wales, and 23,000 on Sunday. It means we are likely to tip over to 60% first dose vaccination today when we hear from the Premier. We're at 41% fully vaccinated, and we're also going to get a boost when Moderna goes into pharmacies on Wednesday. So Queensland well and truly back in the race. Alex.
Good stuff, Jess. Thank you.
Former Attorney General Christian Porter is under pressure to resign from Parliament after moving to the backbench. Live tonight, political editor Chris Yeoman in Canberra. Chris, where's this pressure coming from?
Ali, the Labor Party, the Greens, minor parties in Parliament who think he's not just breached ministerial standards but breached the standards that are set for MPs. We might see an inquiry into that through what's called the Privileges Committee. There'll no doubt be a lot of heat and dust kicked up about it. But an important point to remember is no one can make a Member of Parliament resign. They have to do that themselves. People often call for the Prime Minister to expel people from Parliament. The Prime Minister does not have that power. Only the people of Pearce, in the seat that where Christian Porter sits have the power to expel him from Parliament at an election. If he decides to resign, well, that's his business. But don't forget that between now and the next election, the government just has a one-seat majority in Parliament, so I don't think the Prime Minister wants him going anywhere.
No, he won't indeed, will he? And, hey, Chris, the Prime Minister travelling to the United States today, but, I mean, his troubles, they're over in Paris.
Lies, deceit, betrayal, you name it, the French have called us that because of us breaking this deal that we had to build 12 submarines with the French in favour of at least eight nuclear-powered submarines with the UK and the US. It's also causing some waves for the United States president, who's having to get on the phone to Emmanuel Macron, and the French are talking about getting rid of or trying to block a free trade deal that Australia has with the European Union. But this is a monumental moment in Australia's history. We've seen a pivot really more towards Washington. We're seeing the Prime Minister going for a meeting with the leaders of what's called the Quad, which is India, Japan, Australia and the United States. So big shifts in what's going on in our region, and most of it's driven by a more aggressive China.
Do you think it's going to blow over with France pretty quickly?
It might take some time. But don't forget, we've had problems with the French before in the Pacific, and in those times it was the French that were at fault, French nuclear testing the Pacific. Don't forget, they sank the Rainbow Warrior back in 1985. So we've had some pretty bleak times in the past, and we've gotten over that. So I assume in time we'll get over it, but this is no small matter.
We'll be right. And in the meantime, Barnaby Joyce is our acting Prime Minister, so it'll be interesting.
Strap yourself in.
We strong consider it.
What could possibly go wrong?
We're about to find out, my friend. Thanks, Chris. Talk to you soon.
Fine. Let's go to live pictures out of the Spanish Canary Islands right now.
Wow.
Where a volcano is erupting.
That's unbelievable.
Isn't it? Jets of lava and ash are being spewed into the air, forcing thousands to evacuate the island of La Palma. A 4.2 magnitude earthquake was recorded before the eruption. It's been happening for about a week, smaller eruptions, and then that. The first eruption since 1971. We hope everyone's okay.
Okay, more now on Melbourne's long-awaited roadmap to freedom, with the lockdown to drag on until at least October 26.
But the plan comes with a warning, with new modelling from the Burnett Institute suggesting the darkest days are still to come. And for more, we are joined by Melbourne Lord Mayor Sally Capp. Nice to see you this morning, Sally. This roadmap out is being described as slow and cautious. Is it too cautious?
Well, the immediate response, Ali, and good morning, Carl, as well. The immediate response has been really despondency. People were hoping for much bigger steps forward, and these have really been baby steps. There's also a lot of information missing in the roadmap for our theatres, for our galleries, our museums. But at the end of the day, this is the start of the roadmap, and this is a great way that we can show people power and we can get to those threshold 70% fully vaxxed and 80% fully vaxxed as quickly as possible and get ourselves open.
Look, the Herald Sun, it has not missed the Premier this morning. They've called it basically hopeless and shameful, the roadmap that has been showed so far. I mean, that sums up to a degree what a lot of people are feeling in Melbourne this morning, right?
Yeah, look, the steps are very cautious. I think it was positive when the Premier started by saying when we hit that 70% fully vaccinated level that we will no longer have lockdowns. There was joy in people's hearts. Unfortunately, then, the baby steps forward mean that we will definitely be the city that's had the most lockdown days in the world, that even as we start to reopen, those steps are very incremental when people were hoping to step more confidently into the future. And I think it's because Victorians have been so good, so compliant, so respectful of the rules, that they're wanting something back from the state government to recognise that effort. And it isn't really demonstrated in these first two steps. But nonetheless, we're going to keep saying they are our first two steps and we need to smash those targets and we need to get ourselves open as quickly as possible.
Yeah, look, I think you might see a fair bit of pushback over the coming days and weeks in regards to it. But what? How are you going to make or help make hospitality and retail work? If it's they're going to be able to operate outdoors but with crowd limits, how can you make that work moving forward and what does Christmas look like for them?
Yeah, so look, we're really getting our skates on. We literally want to turn our city inside out. If outdoor trading is possible at that 70% fully vaxxed, we want to have as many restaurants, cafes, pubs, retailers, businesses outside so that they can welcome as many patrons and customers as possible. It's absolutely vital that we help these business owners and their teams get going. So we will be looking at how we can fast track more of those businesses to be able to operate outdoors. And as I said, that lead into Christmas is absolutely vital. Many traders I spoke to yesterday felt they weren't going to have much to look forward to this Christmas. But again, let's just make the best of this and show that we can help our traders get back on their feet and get open as quickly as possible.
Okay, so you're going to fast track some of those regulations, which is a good thing, and there might be a lot to do. Also, the Chamber of Commerce, I know this morning, is saying that effectively they're worried about losing business to New South Wales, so they're going to have to get their skates on. But Sally, what are you most looking forward to doing when you come out of this?
Well, we've been saying over the weekend, Carl, like many people, I am bursting to be naughty. I am absolutely bursting to get out and about. And then I realised that being naughty is actually just being normal. We just want to get on with doing what we like. And that is what we were hoping for in the roadmap. But come on, Victorians, let's get to that 70% and then the 80% as soon as humanly possible and give ourselves the best chance of being normal again.
It might, you know what, it might just be the greatest slogan for Melbourne moving forward. Naughty. Normal.
I'm up for it.
Same.
Well, we can't wait to come down to Melbourne and be naughty
it's
with
how
you,
we roll.
Sally.
That's it. Thank you so
I'll
much.
I'll send you a formal invitation.
Oh, yeah, we'll be there. Thank you.
Good stuff. Thank you, Sally.